Let's pray. Father, Mother, thank you for this beautiful morning. Lord, that we can come with great hope and expectation, that even though we at times are overwhelmed with all our failures and our poor choices, Lord, we know for sure, because of what you promised, that you forgive them all. And you've given us the promise that blessed is the man that whom you choose. And God, we thank you that we're the chosen people. And because of that, you cause us to approach you, that we may dwell in your courts. And because of that, Lord, we're going to be satisfied with all the goodness of this house. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' most precious name. And other people scream, amen. Amen. Wonderful Jesus. Last week, we talked about eternal life, the super abundant life that God wants us to have. And the main verse, somebody remember the verse, 1 John chapter 5. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. And who has a Son has life. Very simple verse, and I hope that by the end of the series, you'll be able to memorize at least 12 Bible verses to transform your life. See, God has given us eternal life. Now, eternal life is not just about, oh, one day I'm going to go to heaven. No, no, it's about living on this earth like heaven on earth. Pastor, I'm still in that imperfect situation and the environment is still far from perfect. Yeah, because Jesus is in your heart. You may be living in a one-room flat, but you feel like the richest man on this earth because Christ is in your heart. While you're praying towards and while you're moving towards the great destiny that God has for you, you're at rest because you know that Christ is with you. And even if the worst can happen to you, Paul says, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. When I'm living, I have Christ. Even if I die, I gain. So you cannot lose when you're in Christ. And other people say, and this life is in his Son. In other words, it is not so much, well, I learned 5 principles, 6 keys to success. It's not about more laws or rules or regulations or principles. It's about knowing Jesus Christ. The uniqueness about Christianity is not about more rules, more regulations. It's about Christ. In him is life. And what kind of a life that God gives us? And we give you the confession. I hope you've been doing that. That's an astounding confession. Telling us, even as we confess every morning, that you are a new creation. You're a child of the Most High God. You're a seed of Abraham. You have champion blood on the inside of you. You are a masterpiece created in Christ Jesus. As you belong to Christ, you have everything that you need. Every talent, every resource, every gifting you need to fulfill the abundant, super abundant, over, above, beyond measure life and rich in every areas of your life. You're not going to be stuck with setbacks, adversities, because you know God, your friend, Christ, your friend, is already arranging things in your favor, lining up great opportunities for you, breakthroughs, and great, great connection. And other people say, man, what kind of a life do we have? That's astounding. Superb, super abundant life. Now, today we're going to talk about the amazing freedom that God can give to you despite of your bad choices. How many of you have never made bad choices? God says he's able to set you free to fulfill your destiny. You look at the Bible, there are men and women of God. None of them are perfect. None of them, you can say, perfectly righteous. They all have their shortfalls. Peter, for example, you remember, denied Jesus Christ 3 times? But how many must know our God is a God of second chance. And Peter lived to fulfill his destiny to build God his church. And the Apostle Paul was a persecutor of the church. But God is a God of second chance. He moved on to fulfill his destiny. And he wrote 3/4 of the New Testament. Rahab was a prostitute. But God is a God of second chance. And she encountered grace. And she moved on to be the great, 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 great grandmother of Jesus Christ, the human grandmother. That's amazing. And I can think of David. David was an adulterer and a murderer. But God is a God of second chance. And he moved on, labored not as an adulterer, labored not as a murderer, but labored as a man after God's heart. Don't let men put a label on you. What is important is how God labels you. This morning's message, you're not here by accident. Sit up on the right, you're not here by accident. God is saying to you, despite of the bad choices that you have made, you don't have to be stuck in your past. You can still move on, be set free. You have astounding, amazing freedom in Christ because of what Christ did. because of the redemption that we have in Christ Jesus. Look at Ephesians, Paul's letter to the Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7.
In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace.
Wow, in him we have redemption. Now, what does that word redemption mean? Now, the word redemption is a big word. If you look at the English, you're not going to exhaust the meaning of the word redemption. We got to go to the original language of the Bible, which of course is Greek. In Greek, redemption means to be set free by a ransom paid in full. Free from debt. How many are in debt? Free from slavery. Sin is going to put us into slavery. Free from curse for the bad choices we have made. Freedom from the penalty of sin. From Latin, is to free, to release, to deliver, to buy back, to pay a ransom. And how many must know, the Bible tells us, in him we have redemption through his blood. Is that amazing? Sometimes you feel, oh, Pastor, you don't know what I've done, the bad things that I've done. Let me tell you, Pastor, I have exhausted the grace of God. I have got my second chance, I got my third chance, and I got my fifth chance. I think, Pastor, I'm beyond chance right now. Now, I got revelation for you. You think you're bad. In God's eye, the God that sees you perfectly knows you're much worse. Yeah. The revelation is you are much, 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 much more worse than you could ever imagine. But the beautiful truth from the Bible is that the God who knows you perfectly loves you infinitely. He paid the highest price for us. In him is redemption through his blood. God coming down. Remember last week we talked about the only begotten son. He gave his only begotten son. What does that mean? It means that it's the only time in world history God coming down in human form for one purpose, to die for us. In him we have redemption through his blood. And Christ paid the highest price to set us free from our bad choices and from the penalty that we deserve. Think of the passage in Psalms 86, verse 5.
O Lord, you are so good, so ready to forgive, so full of unfailing love for all who ask for your help.
Oh, I love this verse. It's one of my favorite verses. God is so ready to forgive. How many of us know that God is never tired of us coming to him to receive forgiveness? God is never tired of us coming to him. The problem is that we are tired to come to him. God is never tired because he has paid the highest price for us. Take a look in 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. This is 1 verse 7 and 1 verse 9. Are these all of the most astounding verses in the entire Bible? And of course, some commentators say that these are actually addressed to non-believers, but there are certain timeless, eternal truths that is applicable for believers and non-believers. 1 John 1, 7.
But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin.
Blood of Christ cleanses us from what sin? All. What do you mean by word all? Does it mean all kinds? How many say amen to that? Say all kinds. Does it mean all times? Yeah. You can say, oh man, only all kind, but not all time. Some people can believe that God can forgive us of our past sin, perhaps present sin. But how many must know all means past, present, and future. That is astounding. Let me tell you, you think it's astounding, it's because you don't see how infinite valuable is the blood of Christ is. When you see how valuable the blood of Christ is, God in human form, it is that kind of sinless blood, Christ's blood, die for us. You know that, man, there's nothing. The blood of Christ cleanses us from all sin. Next passage in verse 9.
But if we freely admit that we have sinned, we find him reliable and just. He forgives our sins and makes us thoroughly clean from all that is evil.
Wow. The Bible tells us that he's reliable and just. In other words, God is saying to us, if you come to him and ask for forgiveness, and he doesn't forgive you, he is not just. He is not doing justice to what Christ did on the cross. The blood that cleanses us from us. In other words, it is only just today that we come to him. So, to receive the complete forgiveness of our sin. So, the first key thing is you can be set free. from your past, set free from what you feel the bad choices you have made to fulfill your destiny. Because some people thought, oh, Pastor, I made that bad choice, I'm condemned to live a life of the second best. No, no, that's a devil's lie. Because Christ has already set you free from the bad choices, and you can still live to the fullest when you come to Him, because in Him, how many must know, is redemption, that means set free to fulfill your destiny through His blood. The next phrase that I wanted to touch on, this is a powerful key to fulfill our destiny, is because of that redemption, the purchase by the blood, we have the forgiveness of our sins. Say the forgiveness of our sins. So, Pastor, I know that God has forgiven me of all my sin, but how come I don't have the joy? How come I don't have the peace? Well, look at Psalms 32, verse 2.
Yes, what joy for those whose record the Lord has cleared of guilt, whose lives are lived in complete honesty.
Now, in order to experience that joy of forgiveness, God has already forgiven us. That is the fact, that is the truth. But in order to experience the joy of that forgiveness, you've got to be honest with what we have done. What does that mean, to be honest with what we have done? That means we don't cover up. That means we don't try to give all kinds of excuses. This is a story of this little boy and the girl. The boy got a special birthday gift, a bean bag. A teddy bear bean bag. Wow, so excited. One day, the boy have a quarrel with a girl, and the girl, very angry, very upset, took that teddy bear bean bag, dug a hole in the garden, buried it, and thinking nobody knows. How can the boy ever discover it? But after a few months, the beans in the bean bag started to sprout and grow the shape of a bag. The bean bag, the teddy bear. Friend, let me tell you. We got to be honest, because we can't cover, we can't give excuses. It's a matter of time. You're not going to have that kind of a joy and happiness in life. You try to cover up. And what is the key? Instead of covering up, the key is to acknowledge it. Look at Psalm 32, verse 3.
For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer.
You know this, when we try to cover up, when you're honest, not honest, with admitting our faults, you notice it says, my bone going to be wasted away, my strength going to be dried up. Look at verse 5. What happened when we do something about it?
I acknowledge my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity.
Someone must know, God will restore that joy. Now, to acknowledge your faults and failure does not mean confessing your sins every day, spending long hours self-examining yourself. How many of you have a set time of confession of sin to the wife every day? Oh, Monday, confession time to my spouse at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And then at 7 o'clock is confession time to my mom and dad. And then Monday at 3 o'clock, confession time to my boss. No, you don't need a confession time, regimented time. But every time that you're troubled, every time you realize that you make a bad choice, you be honest, not to cover up and not to make excuses. And when you go and apologize, you don't say, "Hun, I'm sorry if I have hurt you." Now, that is not confession. That is not acknowledging a fault. That is actually denial. If you really apologize, there's no if. You just, "Honey, I'm sorry because I have hurt you." That's it. No excuses, no cover-up, no trying to undermine what we have done. The question is, what happens if we try to cover up? Maybe try to cover up as what David experienced. You know, David committed adultery and murder. He kept that for 1 year before he was confronted by the prophet Samuel. And do you know that 1 year, he lived a life of tremendous misery and torment. God has already forgiven him, but the fact is that because he was not honest and not acknowledged and addressed the issue, he was living in torment. Hear the story of Sam and Susan. Both of them went to grandma's house for a holiday, school holiday, right? This season, school holiday. Sam took that sling that he has. He was playing around with the sling and accidentally shot Grandma's pet duck. And he looked around and said, oh, thank God, nobody saw except his sister. During dinner time, they were having a wonderful time. And then Grandma said, who's going to do the dishes after the dinner? And Susan answered, Grandma said, oh, Sam, by the way, just volunteered. Just before that Sam was able to protest, Susan whispered to the ear of Sam, remember the duck. Oh, yes, Grandma, I'm going to do the dishes. The next day, Grandpa said, let's go for fishing. And wow, so happy. But Grandma said, no, one of you got to stay back. Susan, you got to stay back and help me do the chores. I need somebody to help me to do the chores. Susan, no, Sam has volunteered. Just before Sam got a chance to protest, Susan whispered to the ear of Susan, remember the duck. Oh, yes, Grandma, I did volunteer. This goes on for a couple of days until Sam couldn't stand it all any further. So finally, he go and admit that he has actually killed the grandma's pet. And Grandma said, actually, I know all along. I saw it behind the windows. I'm just waiting to see how long you're going to allow your sister Susan to make you a slave. The point is that God has already forgiven us. He cleanses us from all sin, past, present, and future. But because we are not honest in acknowledging it, we are tormented. And how many of us know when we are honest and take responsibility? Someone said, I can't remember who, some kind of a thing that I got it over the years. Accepting responsibility for our mistakes is the key to mental and emotional and spiritual health. I heard the report from a group of doctors, they're not even Christian doctors, that said you can actually empty half of the hospitals if they know they have been forgiven of their sins. Because if they know, any psychologist will tell you that half of the diseases, half of the problem diseases has its root in guilt and condemnation that comes along with that kind of a stress, all right, the torment that come out of that. And the key thing is, you got to be honest in acknowledging. God has already forgiven us, but we got to be honest. And what happened when we open to acknowledge our sins? Psalm 139 says,
search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxious thoughts.
See, the key thing is we got to be honest with God. Sometimes God can use people to correct us, just like God used the prophet Nathan to confront David. David didn't really admit his sin until he was cornered and confronted, right? But God used people. We got to be open. When God does use people to confront us, then we got to be open. To correct us, we got to be open. And what happened when we open? Verse 24.
And see if there be any hurtful way in me, and lead me in the everlasting way.
Now, two things we can see from this biblical passage. Number one is that when we open, to allow God to correct us even through people. Number one, it's going to keep us from hurting ourselves. Because when we don't acknowledge our mistake, and we keep repeating the same thing, I'm going to know, it's going to jeopardize the great destiny. For example, if you're a mediocre person, and you end up wondering why you can never get a promotion, and you don't deal with the fact that you are mediocre and lazy, and you find that you're not going to be able to get that kind of promotion that you're looking for. You're not going to be noticed because there's lack of excellence. So when we don't honest with ourselves, you find that you're going to be hurting ourselves. And another blessing that comes out of an open heart to acknowledge our failures is it leads us in the everlasting way. In other words, you're going to see that God can take us to enduring success. Next passage in Proverbs 28, verse 13.
He who covers his transgressions and faults will not prosper, but he who honestly acknowledges it will find compassion, acceptance, and grace to deal with it and overcome and thrive.
Wow. In other words, when you acknowledge, you find you have compassion, you have acceptance and grace to deal with it and overcome and thrive. Now, when you acknowledge your faults and failure, it is not to apologize, say sorry, and demand forgiveness. See, sometimes people are like that. I'm already saying sorry, what? So what? And you hurt your wife, you hurt your spouse. I'm sorry. How come he didn't immediately be happy and show a good face? Hey, come on. When we say sorry, that does not mean that you can demand for immediate restoration. See, the point is that forgiveness is free. Trust is earned. Just because somebody comes and says sorry and he has cheated you in your business, forgiving him is one thing. You're not bitter, you're not angry. That's right. It is good. You're not going to be tormented when you're not upset and angry and full of resentment. But it doesn't mean that you've got to do business with him again. Because forgiveness is free. Trust is earned. The joker, even before marriage, already playing around with girls. And come to you, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Now, of course, you forgive. You're not going to be allowing tormenting spirit to torment you. But it does not mean, just because you forgive him, it does not mean you marry him. See, forgiveness is free, trust is earned. So just because you say sorry, it does not mean that you can demand immediate restoration. It simply means if we acknowledge our sin, it means to be open to make changes in our life. Like Zacchaeus, remember when Zacchaeus encountered Christ, he said, I return what I have cheated, he said, 4 times. I give half my property away. So in other words, be open to changes that is needed. Okay, when you make a mistake, you say a lie or did something which is wrong, you've got to do something to rectify the situation. And we do that, it's not going to embarrass you. It is going to restore your honor 7 times, another people say. That's what Zacchaeus did. And one of the lessons in the Kingdom Dynamics class, we're going to see how God gave us the power to transform us from one level of glory to another level of glory. You see, God loves you as you are. God sees you in your entire weakness. He loves you perfectly. And he has already forgiven you totally. But the point is that he loves you too much to let you continue as you are. He's going to release that grace that enables us to bring about astounding changes in our life. And he loves you as you are. He's forgiven you already, but he loves you too much to let you continue the way you are, because God wants you to move up, to fulfill the destiny that God has. That brings us a very powerful thing about acknowledgement. When you acknowledge your faults, it says here, you'll find compassion, acceptance, and grace to deal with it and overcome and thrive. Now, when we acknowledge our faults and sin, it is not to acknowledge, apologize, and then demand for forgiveness. Oh, Pastor, I don't understand my wife. I already say sorry to her already. And yet she's still very angry with me. Hey, how many of us know, yeah, you can apologize, but that doesn't mean that you can demand for immediate restoration. The point is that, how many of us know, forgiveness is free, but trust is earned. Just because somebody come to you and they have cheated you in business, and then he apologized, he said, I'm sorry, and he will have tears of repentance, so to speak, doesn't mean that you've got to trust him and do business with him again, because I'm going to know, forgiveness is free, trust is earned. Your boyfriend, before even marriage, it's already womanizing, all right? And he come to you and say sorry again and again, now you of course will forgive him, all right? At least you have the peace of mind. You're not going to be tormented with resentment and anger. But it does not mean that you marry him just because he apologized. All right? The key is trust is earned, forgiveness is free. So just because you apologize does not mean that you can demand forgiveness. It simply means to be open for God to work changes in our life. Look at Zacchaeus when he was dining at Jesus' house, remember? And the people were saying all kinds of things about him, that he did this, he did that, it was wrong. Zacchaeus immediately say that I will give half of my property to the poor, and what I have cheated, I return back fourfold. In other words, Zacchaeus, touched by grace, was open to make changes in his life. So in other words, you did something wrong. Maybe you lie, or maybe you did something bad. I could be open to what God is saying to you to do about some changes in your life. And some of you must know that it's not going to embarrass you. It's going to restore you, restore your honor 7 times more when we're open to make changes in our life. You know, one of the lessons in Kingdom Dynamic class is to share how God is able to transform us, to change it. What kind of a thing that God could use to enable us, to give us the energy, the power to change our life for the better. You see, God loves you infinitely. And God forgiven you completely. That's for sure. But at the same time, look up. God loves you too much to let you remain as you are, because God has a high destiny for you. God loves you too much to let you go, continue to walk in ways going to destroy your destiny. God wants you to rise up, allow Him to come, pour out His energy and power in your life, pour out His grace in your already forgiven you. But open to the changes that God wants to work in our life. And that brings us to a very powerful verse in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 17.
Then he says, I will never again remember their sins and lawless deeds. And when sin has been forgiven, there is no need to offer any more sacrifices.
See, God said, I will never remember. When it should come and acknowledge, all right, your faults to Him, the bad choices, God said, I never remember. What does that mean? It means that God doesn't want you to be focused on your sin or sin conscious. All right? And it says in verse 18, and when sin has been forgiven, there is no need to offer any more sacrifice. The key thing is open our heart to receive His grace, the forgiveness, the grace also to empower our life, to change us for the better. And for a long time, I've been wondering, how come Peter was restored and Judas was not? I've been asking and searching through all the commentators. I don't really get a satisfactory answer until one day the Lord began to tell me the reason is because Judas didn't receive grace, whereas Peter received grace. The answer is so simple. How? Because remember, after Judas had betrayed Jesus, he came to the priest and threw back 18 pieces of silver to the priest. He think by paying back, he get his forgiveness. No, how many must know? It's not about we paying back what we have done. Peter is different. Peter received grace. Remember the resurrection? Peter was trying to make a catch, but there's no catch, and Jesus at the shore, remember? And then he got them to fish, and 153 big fishes, and Jesus prepared a great meal for them. They came, they ate, they are being fed to the brim with God's grace. And friend, how many must know, grace is the greatest amazing power for change. But if you think that you're going to pay for your faults, it could be that which hinder you from what God has for you. Like when you're confronted by your boss, you get very upset because your boss corrected you. I don't know why my boss, what's the big deal? Always finding fault at me. What's the big deal? I told him that day, I pay him back long for what I have done. That is arrogance at its height. You know why? Because I think the boss is not concerned about paying back. The boss is concerned with your attitude. Are you open to correction and change? The better attitude is, thank you, boss, that you're loving enough to correct me. And thank you so much. Please help me to overcome. Help me to be a better worker. You would have received grace from your boss to become a better worker. And other people say, amen. The key is, how come Peter was restored and Judas was not? Because Judas was trying to pay. It says here that, and when sin has been forgiven, there is no need to offer any more sacrifices. It's not about your sacrifice, you're paying back. You can't pay back what you did, even with the boss. The key thing is, number one must know, is to receive grace. The same thing. What is the greatest motivation for change? It is not, man, I change to earn my forgiveness. No, you have already been forgiven. And now, you get a motivation to change. You got a power to change. And you want to change because you acknowledge your faults. Look at James chapter 5, verse 16.
Admit your faults to one another and pray for each other so that you may be healed.
Wow! That get word heal is not just getting physical healing. And I check up the Greek word for healing from the analytical lexicon. This is not the Strong's, but another lexicon, another dictionary. It means to heal. It means to deliver. It means to restore. It means to make whole. It means to recover. Man, when we learn to be honest and acknowledge our faults, not giving excuses, not covering up, one of the things that's going to happen is that we're going to receive that grace, not just for healing, but deliverance, restoration, being made whole. And how many must know when we make a bad choice, God is not surprised. Man, why did I choose that person? He made that plunder. No, God is not surprised. How many must know God already got a comeback for every setbacks in your life? You know the story, this minister, a very successful man, successful ministry, but he kind of make a stupid mistake, a bad choice, a wicked choice, lost his family. And he was devastated. He thought, life is finished for me, and I'm washed up. There's nothing for me for the future. One day, he went with his friend to South America. His friend was an evangelist. So he was up on the stage, sitting with a pastor, a South American pastor. And the South American pastor looked at him and began to cry and cry and cry, non-stop, long, long time, almost an hour, and he keep crying. And later on, this preacher that has made a bad choice asked him, "Why did you cry when you saw me?" "Sir, I saw you in a vision 20 years ago, and God asked me to pray for your restoration." 20 years before that guy had made a bad choice, God has already made a key for restoration. Somebody asked to pray for him. How many of us know God has already got a comeback for every setback in your life? The kidding is, we must ready to open to what He has for us. All right? Be open to acknowledge our faults. All right? Not deny, not give excuses. And Hebrew chapter 10, verse 2.
"For the worshippers once purified would have no more consciousness of sins."
You know, when you acknowledge honestly your bad choices, not giving excuses, all right? How many of us know that it has been completely cleansed? And you know what? You would not have consciousness of sin. Now, why do you think that God doesn't want you to dwell in your sin, even as you acknowledge honestly what you have done? See, the more you continue to be conscious, "Oh, Pastor, I did this, I did that," you're going to continue to sin. Because when you're conscious of your sin, the more you're going to sin. Number two, you're going to be stuck in the past. All right? "Oh, Pastor, you know, I got this sickness. I know it's because of stress. I know because of, I say, kind of full of fear. And I know it's because of this or that. That's the reason I got this sickness." Yeah, it may be true. Even doctors tell us that 50% of sicknesses is due to stress and due to guilt and condemnation and the stress that come out of it. It may be true. It may be because of that. But God says, even if you acknowledge it, don't look back, move on. Because God says, even as you do acknowledge, God says, you will be healed. You will be restored, and you're going to be made whole, and you are going to see astounding restoration. And the key thing is, we must know, God doesn't want us to keep stuck, being stuck with guilt and condemnation. Now, this brings us to the third phrase in our study, all right, on how God sets you free to fulfill your destiny, despite all the bad choices. Remember, number one, in Him we have redemption through His blood. All right? And number two, the forgiveness of our sin that is purchased through the redemption through His blood. Number three, according to the riches of His grace. I hope you can memorize Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17. It's a very simple verse, but man, it's going to really transform your life. I think it's going to be releasing that kind of a dynamic for us to experience heaven and earth. And it is according to the riches of His grace. We're able to receive the complete forgiveness of our sin is because of the riches of His grace. At the same time, we're able to forgive those that have hurt us, same way, according to the riches of His grace. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32.
"Instead, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you."
We're able to forgive others because we have been forgiven. In other words, when you receive grace, you're going to be able to release grace. The story of this little boy who wanted to have a puppy. He got only 39 cents. He took a long time to save 39 cents. And this farmer got this litter of baby dogs, puppies. He wanted to have one of the dogs. He came, "Sir, can I have one of the puppy for 39 cents? Of course, the farmer was amazed. I mean, how can you buy a puppy for 39 cents? But because that boy was so sincere, "Okay, I'm going to save one of the puppy. Just choose anyone." It took a long time for him to choose until there was this little puppy that struggled out of the cage. It happened that puppy has a broken leg. And the boy immediately said, "I want to have that puppy with a broken leg." And the farmer was amazed. Why do you want to take that puppy with a broken leg? You're not going to be able to play with him. You're not going to have fun and roll on the ground with him. I mean, you have so many other puppy. The boy insisted to take the puppy with a broken leg. And the farmer couldn't understand until when the boy turned and took off with the puppy, he saw that that boy also has a broken leg. And the boy was have a sympathy for that puppy with the broken leg because he understands grace. He has received grace. He was able to release grace. The fact is that according to the riches of his grace, but you understand how much you have been forgiven, then it's easy for us to forgive others. Now, you forgive others not to earn your forgiveness. You have been forgiven. And out of gratitude, you're given energy and enabling to forgive others. If that is the case, some people may say, oh, Pastor, what about the Lord's Prayer? You know, in Matthew chapter 6, verse 12 says,
and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
Now you get the impression that, well, we forgive our debtors, and because of that, they earn the right to be forgiven. Actually, the Lord's Prayer, that particular phrase, as we forgive, in the Greek, can also be translated as in your notes, and so we forgive our debtors. Forgive our debts, and so. Say, and so. So what does that mean? It means that having been forgiven, and so we do it. And so, in other words, because we have been forgiven, we are able to forgive others. How many of us know that why does God want you to forgive others, having received that grace of forgiveness? It's because God says there is a special blessing for those who forgive others. Look at 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 9.
Not returning evil for evil or insult for insult, but giving a blessing instead. For you were called for the very purpose that you might inherit a blessing.
So when you begin to forgive and release your hurts, how many must know God says you are going to inherit a blessing. And it's amazing. That means that God asks you to forgive. Not for that person's sake. It's for your own sake. Oh, Pastor, that person hurt me so much. And by the way, Pastor, that person never even apologized. God say, forgive not for that person that hurt you sake. It is for your own sake that you may inherit a blessing. Because otherwise, you're going to be tormented, all right, with all kind of resentment, bitterness. Like someone say, resentment is like drinking poison, hoping that your enemy will be killed. How many of us, it doesn't work. You yourself are going to be tormented. How many have seen the show Scarlet and the Black? One of the main actors is Gregory Peck. How many have saw that show, movie? It is an amazing movie that portrays a real-life story of two key individuals. The priest, the real-life story of Father O'Hurley, he's a Catholic priest, and that he was instrumental in saving about 6,000 Allies soldiers, hiding them in monastery, nunnery, and private homes at tremendous risk of his own life. Another guy, the main actor, is Colonel Herbert Kepler. Kepler was the chief of the SS force in Rome, Italy, during the war. And he was instrumental in deporting 2,000 over Jews. And out of that, less than 16 survived. And he was instrumental, Kepler, in the massacre of 300 over civilians, Italians, in Rome in one day. Before the Allies landed to liberate Rome, Kepler had the audacity to demand forgiveness from the priest and ask the priest to save his family. Take a look at this clip.
God, wait. I know about you and your church. I've been talking to people. I know all about you. What is it you want from me, Kepler? They say that you can't pass a beggar or a lame dog, but that you see yourself with some sort of obligation to look after anyone in trouble. You help British and American prisoners, Jews, Arabs, refugees, anybody. It's a part of your faith. Is that right?
Well, I wouldn't deny it. That's why I became a priest.
Brotherly love and forgiveness. That's the other half of what you believe. True?
True.
Well, I'm glad of it. Because I have three more for your mercy wagon. My wife and 2 children. If the partisans get them, they will be killed. I want them out of Rome and safe. That's what I want from you, priest.
You're asking me to save your family.
If you really believe what you preach, you'll do it.
You expect me to help you after what you've done? You think you can demand forgiveness? You think it comes automatically just because you want it?
I'm not talking about myself.
You've turned this city into a concentration camp. You've tortured and butchered my friends. You've violated every principle of God and man. I can't believe it. After all you've done, you want mercy. I told you.
You know, amazing that this Kepler would demand that kind of a help from the priest. And the priest answered, Father O'Furvey, he said, you turned the city into a concentration camp. You butchered all my friends. You violated every principle of God and man, and you dared to ask me for help? And there are people like that. There's always be all kind of things and demanding forgiveness. The question is, did Father O'Furvey help the family? Well, when the Allies landed, Kepler, of course, was being interrogated and being put in prison and sentenced by the courts for life imprisonment. One of the interrogators asked Kepler is, how did your family got the passage to Switzerland? At that point in time, Kepler realized that the father did his job. And months later, the father of Ferdi was the only person that visited Kepler every month without fail for his life imprisonment. And finally, in 1959, he was baptized. And how many of us know grace overrules? And other people say, many, many years ago, this guy came and he was a medium, he was a gangster, he was a drug pusher, he was a drug addict, you can name it. He got about, I think, 7 demons on the inside of him. We didn't know. How many of us know ignorance is bliss? We went and preached the gospel, he received Christ. The demon just go. Months later, he was demonized again. We were surprised. We prayed for 6 hours, couldn't get the release. The Lord gave the word of knowledge. It's the bitterness. And asked him to forgive. And that person happened to be his mother-in-law. And he said, he hates his mother-in-law. But finally, I said, if you want to be delivered from these demons that is torturing you, you got to release. You know what? He released, he forgave, he blessed. The demons goes off just like that. It took 6 hours. The demons couldn't come out. But just the release of that forgiveness, boom, is out. See, how many of us know the issue is not the mother-in-law, what she has done. The issue is we forgive not for the sake of the mother-in-law, but for our own sake. So we move on in life, what God has destined for us. Amen. The point is that you find people like that. And God says, he wants you to forgive, not that person's sake, for your sake, because you are going to inherit an astounding blessing when you do that. You're not going to be stuck with resentment. They're going to kill you, destroy you, but you're going to move on to your destiny despite of what has been done. And finally, the Pope was not, I would say, very troubled by what the priests have done, because it would have jeopardized the church diplomatic immunity. And of course, Hitler can, on the basis of the priests hiding allies, prisoners in the Vatican City, would have used it as the reason to invade Vatican City and take away all the treasure in the Vatican City. So before the Allies came, and while this Father O'Furvey was actively saving prisoners, the Pope took, this is a real story, took the priest down, see all the amazing treasures the church has, and indirectly tried to hint to him, hey, come on, your action going to jeopardize all these treasures of the church. Take this video clip.
This is something I wanted you to see, Monsignor. The glories of the Vatican Palace that I used to love so much when I was a boy, now packed away down here. Irreplaceable treasures, Leonardo, Raphael, and relics infinitely more precious of St. Francis, of St. Catherine of Siena, the records and archives, letters, St. Augustine, Martin Luther.
Martin Luther, Lutherans, huh? The point is that the Pope regarded all this as treasures and tried to hint to Kepler, please stop your action indirectly. But after the Allies landed, and the Pope was about to address the people in the Vatican City, as you normally saw him out in the window, and before he addressed the crowd, he came to see the priest himself.
Two moments. This is a great day. I have to speak to our people. But first, I wanted to speak to you. In this imperfect world, you may never receive the honor that is due to you. But I wanted you to know that in my heart, I honor you. I talked to you once of the treasures of the church. Perhaps I deceived myself.
Notice that even the Pope acknowledged his mistakes.
The real treasures of the church, what makes it imperishable, is that every once in a while, someone comes to it, my son, like you. May the Lord watch over you.
What is the real treasure of the church? The real treasure is not like what the Pope mentioned, the Raphael, the Leonardos, and the archives. It is the people that have been touched by grace, allowed God's grace to permeate through their life and release His mercy, and other people say.
I heard the story of Corrie Ten Boom, how he saw the former Nazi officer that had hurt her sister, killed their father. And after the message on grace, this man came and shake hands. But Corrie couldn't. She couldn't shake hands. She was filled with all kind of feeling. So I would be not honest if I shake hands. Then she prayed a simple prayer. God, help me. And when they said that simple prayer, that's that electrifying power came from top down. And unconsciously, her hand was lifted and shook hand with that former Nazi officer. So it's not about your ability. You got to receive His grace, and humble must know you're going to be able to release grace. And other people say, amen. The key thing is, be set free from whatever bad choices that we have, because God has an amazing destiny for you, despite of what you have done.
Beginning, according to the riches of His grace, we're able to receive forgiveness, able to release forgiveness, and it's because of His grace. And you know what? When we do release His grace, Psalm 23 verse 5 tells us,
"You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You honor me by anointing my head with oil. My cup overflows with blessings."
Wow, God says, even in the midst of offensive, adverse situation, God says, even as you receive grace, forgive and release, you've got to be able to enjoy life. God's grace, you've got to be honored, you've got to have the anointing, and you've got to be that cup, you've got to have that cup overflow, that means blessings, that means abundance. And that is the key, and it's because God has set us free from all our bad choices through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, according to the riches of His grace. And other people say, everyone must know that you can never exhaust God's grace. Some of you may feel, Pastor, I'm exhausted, my second chance, fourth chance, seventh chance, right now, I'm beyond chance. The truth is that you can never exhaust God's grace, because in Him is that redemption, being set free from all our sins and debts, curses, according through His blood. And that blood of Christ is the blood of infinite value. And because of that, we have the complete forgiveness of our sin. God has already forgiven us past, present, and future. The kidding is, we can experience joy and free from torments when we are open to acknowledge our failures and faults, not covering up, not giving excuses, and be open. And we're going to be able to receive that grace to overcome and be healed, be delivered, be made whole. And that is according to the riches of His grace. Oh, Pastor, I can't forgive myself. I can't forgive others. Remember, you can't, but Jesus can. Say, I can't, but Jesus can. Because the end of the day is according not to your goodness, your self-effort, no, according to the riches of His grace. The worshipper, having been once cleansed, there is no more sacrifice, because Christ has did the sacrifice for us. Right now, what we're going to do, we're going to ask you to declare and confess. If your sermon outline, declare who you are in Christ. And I hope you have memorized this. Okay? And also, don't read too loud. Just read your normal style. Not too fast. Follow my pace so that it's not just going to be in the mind, but it really go into the heart. Okay? Say it to me. I am a new creation. Say the same time as me, okay? Just follow my pace. Don't too loud, but too soft, okay? I am a new creation and a child of the Most High God, a masterpiece, worshipfully and wonderfully created in Christ Jesus. There you see, too fast. Allow that word to sing in the heart, all right? Okay, I am a seed of Abraham. I have champion bloodline, and I am destined for great things, heir of the promise and heir of the world. As I belong to Christ, I have every gift and talent of grace needed to live a beyond measure, over and above, super abundant life like heaven and earth, and rich in everything. I will not be stuck and be suffer in life because of any setbacks. I know for sure that He, my very own friend, will keep me strong to the end. And it is always behind the scene, arranging things in my favor, fighting the battles for me, and lining up great connection and opportunities and breakthroughs for me. And other people scream, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, give God a hand. We'd like to close, give an opportunity for those of you who have not known Jesus Christ to be Lord of your life, to say this prayer. Would you join together with me to receive Christ into your life? Say together with me, dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to die for me on the cross. Right now, I receive Him as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, and all of you will scream.
If you have said that prayer and want to know more or have any feedbacks, please write to us. I will be your